Yeah, so thank you for giving me the opportunity to give this presentation. So I work indeed on efficient algorithms to train supermodels. So the next 20 minutes I will explain to you what training a supermodel means to me in the context of weather and climate forecasting. So probably you are familiar with the standard multimodal ensemble approach. So it's often used in operational forecasts. And it just means that if you have a couple of imperfect models, like in this left figure over here, not sure if I see a pointer, then you run your individual models independently, and then you combine their output afterwards. And often this is very helpful, because model errors, they tend to average out. So for example, when one model is too warm, the other model is too cold. And also the spread between the models, it can give you a measure for uncertainty. So multimodal ensemble, it can give you improved statistics, like mean and variance, but it often does not give you an improved trajectory. And that's because if you average the trajectories of the independent models, then you average uncorrelated trajectories. So you will suffer from variance reduction and smoothing. So we think we can do better with supermodeling. So Francois already explained the supermodeling concept, but it's quite a fundamental aspect, so I will quickly tell you about it again. So within a supermodel, the imperfect models interact with each other during the simulation. So as you can see in the figure on the right, they exchange information with each other, indicated by the arrows. So they are dynamically combined. And this dynamical combination is called a supermodel. And what I really like about a supermodel is that you can create new dynamical behavior. So for example, if you have two models that have the same error, but for different reasons, then if you let them interact with each other, you can resolve this error. Another advantage of the supermodel is that you can correct the errors in an earlier stage compared to standard multimodal ensemble. And a very important point is that in a supermodel, the models are synchronized. And that means that you do not suffer from this variance reduction and smoothing. So the models, they talk to each other, and together they decide on a common trajectory to follow. So you do not only get improved statistics, but also an improved trajectory. So how does a supermodel look like? Well, I work with weighted supermodels. And that means that if we have a couple of imperfect models with this denoted their time derivatives, then my supermodel, it's just a weighted superposition of the time derivatives of the imperfect models. And then I want to get a supermodel as optimal as possible. So I want to get the most optimal weights W. So my aim is to train these weights W. So how do I do that? Well, my first training method is based on an idea called cross-pollination in time, originally proposed.
In the previous slide, did you mean W12 is in Rn times n, or just 2n?
So it just means that, for example, so it means that if you, for example, have your state variables temperature and vorticity, then you can have different weights for them. So W is a diagonal matrix with the weights on the diagonal.
Each of them is n to n. W1 and W2, each of them are n to n matrix.
Okay.
In this case, they are diagonal, but the dimension is n times n.
Yeah, so my first training method is based on cross-pollination in time, an idea of Lenny Smith, and already explained by Hailang Du, but I will quickly explain the concept again. So the idea is that you cross different model trajectories. And by crossing these trajectories, you get a larger amount of possible trajectories. You create a larger ensemble. So in that way, you can explore different areas of your state space. And hopefully, in that sense, you can get closer to the truth. So how does this work in practice? Well, assume we have three imperfect models, model 1, model 2, model 3. Then here in this left figure, if we start from one point in state space, then we are going to integrate all three models. So we end up at three different points in state space. And then from these three points, again, we're going to integrate all three models. So this is where this crossing of trajectories happens. And then if we continue this for a certain amount of time steps, then you see that the amount of trajectories, it grows exponentially. So we need to prune. And the way I do this is, well, assume we have a truth, this black line over here in the right figure. Then every time step, I only continue with the model that is closest to the truth. So first here, model 3, then model 2, then model 1. And if we continue this for a certain amount of time steps, then we get an idea of how often each model has been chosen. So in this example, model 1 has been chosen 4 out of 20 time steps, so 20% of the time. And then I use this frequency as a weight for my model. So in this case, model 1 gets a weight factor of 0.2. Then I have another learning method I use, a synchronization-based learning rule, originally developed by Greg Dwayne. And I will not go into the details of this learning rule, why it works. It's a product of the error between the supermodel and the truth and the time derivative of an imperfect model. And it was originally developed for parameter estimation. But the difference between this method and CPT is that with this method, you update the weights during training. So for example, you start with equal weights. For model 1, the red line, and model 2, the blue line. And then during training, you update your weights such that the supermodel, this green line, synchronizes with the truth, the black line. So here you can see an example that now, after some time, the red model has got much more weights than the blue model. And then I will show you some experiments with the SPIDO model. So for the ones who do not know it, it's a intermediate complex global coupled atmosphere ocean land model. And to give you an idea about the size, the spatial resolution at the equator is around 700 kilometers. Then I have only imperfections in my atmospheres. And during training, I also have a perfect atmosphere. And the perfect atmosphere communicates its results to the imperfect atmospheres, indicated by this red line. And also, the imperfect atmosphere calculates its fluxes and gives that to the ocean and the land model. And then the ocean and the land model, they compute their results and give that back to all the atmospheres. So in that sense, during training, you work with a perfect ocean and land model. So this is then how my supermodel looks like. Now we don't have a perfect atmosphere anymore. So both atmospheres, they each calculate their own fluxes. And then the ocean and land model, they receive a weighted average of them. So my goal is now to build a weighted supermodel with weights learned both from CPT and the synchro. So in my first experiment, I have two imperfect models. And the imperfections lie within the parameters. I have different parameter values. And the parameters I chose to perturb are relaxation timescale of convection, relative humidity threshold, and momentum diffusion timescale. And the reason I chose these parameters is because uncertainties in climate models often lies within cloud parameterization and convection. So perturbing these parameter values gives a realistic spread of climate models. And then my training period, well, CPT is a very fast method, So already after a couple of time steps, you get an idea how often each model has been chosen. So it's only 1 week. But the sync rule, it needs a bit more time to converge. It needs about a year. So because of that, I did the CPT rule 52 times. Then I work so far with global weights, which means that every grid point of the model obtains the same weight. But I do have different weights for temperature, vorticity, and divergence. So temperature, vorticity, and divergence are the variables I exchange between the models. So then after training, I calculated a trajectory for 40 years. And here, if you look at the global average temperature, then you see that both supermodels, the pink line and the orange line, they are clearly quite close to the perfect model, the black line. So that's good. And they are clearly much better than the imperfect models, so the dark red line and the dark blue line. But in this case, the imperfect models, they compensate for each other. So one is too warm and the other is a bit too cold. So if you would now calculate a multimodal mean with optimal weights, then you would get this green line over here. And you see that the green line is actually as good as the supermodels. So that's a bit annoying because we want to be better than the multimodal mean. But luckily, if you look at the short-term forecast error, so here I calculated the root mean squared error between the perfect model and a trajectory with a slightly perturbed initial condition. Then you see that, well, also the perfect model gets some error because of chaos. And then both supermodels, again, the pink and the orange line, they are not perfect, clearly, but they are much better than the imperfect models. And also better than the multimodal ensemble trajectory. So this shows indeed that multimodal ensemble does not always work well because you average out things. Then I have another experiment I would like to show you. So this is with four imperfect speedo models. The first one is the same as before, and then I have three other models. And the perturbations in the parameter values, they are actually the same as the previous experiment, but they are distributed differently. So why would I do this? Well, because of the convex hull principle. So probably you are familiar with that, but just to be sure, convex hull means that if the parameters appear linear in the equations, which they don't in this case, then you can make a perfect linear combination with positive weights of the imperfect parameter values that's equal to the perfect parameter value. So you can see it in this figure here on the right, as if the imperfect parameter values, they surround the truth. So then if we look again at the long-term forecast quality, the global average temperature over 40 years, then we see again that both supermodels, the pink and the orange line, they are again close to the truth. So that's good. But what's actually more interesting is that all imperfect models in this case, they overestimate the temperature. So if you would calculate a multimodal mean with positive weights from these imperfect models, you will never get something that is better than the best imperfect model. So this shows that not only on short-term forecast, but also on long-term forecast, the supermodel can be better than the multimodal mean. But what happens if all parameter values are smaller than the perfect parameter values? Then you cannot apply this convex hull principle anymore, unless you work with negative weights. So CPT, so far, it's not straightforward to get negative weights because you're just counting how often you've used each model. I think, however, it's not impossible, so I'm working on an algorithm that I can still get negative weights with CPT. I will not show that now. But for the sync rule, on the other hand, we didn't impose any constraints. So the weights, they automatically sum up to 1, and they also came out positive because of this convex hull principle. But now in this case, maybe we will get negative weights, stable negative weights. And if we indeed get negative weights, then we will see if we get a supermodel that's actually feasible. So if we look at the training period, then you see that indeed we get negative weights as expected, or at least for vorticity and temperature. Also, the weights, they seem to converge quite quickly. So at least we have reached a local minimum. But yeah, that does not say everything. But then again, if we calculate for 40 years, then well, at least the supermodel with the negative weights does not crash. So that's already a good thing. But also, if we, for example, look at the average error in wind at 200 hectopascal over 30 years, then you see that both imperfect models, well, they have quite large errors. Imperfect model 6 is, yeah, way worse also than imperfect model 1, and they have errors in the same direction. But then if we look at the supermodel, then you still see that there are errors. It's not perfect, it's far from perfect, but it's clearly better than both imperfect models. And also when we look at the short-term forecasts, then, well, again, the supermodel, it's far from perfect, but it's at least an improvement compared to both imperfect models. So the results I showed you so far, they also appear in my paper, which just got accepted for publication. But then I would also like to show you some very preliminary work. Because so far I assumed that we work with perfect observations. And unfortunately, observations are not perfect. So this is a first experiment with noisy observations. The error is Gaussian distributed with a standard deviation of half a degree. And every grid point, it gets a different error. And of course, this is not very realistic because actually you should look at spatially or time correlated errors. But it's the first step towards working with noisy observations and to see if this works. Well, luckily, this first step goes quite OK. So if we look at the supermodels trained on noisy observations, then actually we do not see any difference for the long-term forecast between the supermodel with noisy observations or trained on perfect observations. And then if we look at the short-term forecast, then it seems as if the supermodels trained on noisy observations, so the dotted lines, they seem to be slightly worse than the supermodels trained on perfect observations, but yeah, it's still quite good. So that's a relief. But then, of course, we need many more things in order to move forward to more realistic scenarios. So one thing is sparse observations, sparse in time. So far, I assumed we have every time step an observation. But if this assumption does not hold, then it's much more difficult to train the supermodels with CBT and the sync rule, because it's really difficult to follow the observations. So I have some preliminary ideas how to overcome these issues. So for CPT, one idea is to work with an iterative method, and then the idea is to just do your CPT training as before. So you get your supermodel weights, and then again you're going to train your supermodel, but then instead of only choosing your imperfect models, you can also choose your supermodel as being closest by. So hopefully your supermodel is better than the imperfect models, and in this way you can better follow your trajectories and fine-tune your weights. But this will not always be enough. So if the observations are so sparse that, for example, the imperfect models already reached their own attractor, then CPT is always going to give you the same model. So you will always choose the model whose attractor is closest to the truth. So if you have two imperfect models, you will just get weights 0 and 1, which might not be optimal. So the idea is to use techniques from data assimilation to keep the imperfect models closer to the observations. But you do not necessarily want to bring your imperfect models as close as possible to the observations. So the idea of CPT is that you can see how your models can compensate for each other. So that's why I work now with nudging, because with nudging you can still control the distance between the observations and the models, such as you can still see the characteristic behavior of the models. Then for the sync rule, during the sync rule we are already nudging towards the observations, also if we have every time step an observation in order to synchronize. But this is not enough if you have sparse observations. So if you only update your weights by using this time derivative of the imperfect model, then you get unstable results. So yeah, preliminary idea is now to average this derivative over the time window. So to summarize, well, we have seen that weighted supermodels, they can outperform both in short-term and in long-term forecasts the imperfect models, but also the multimodal mean. But then, of course, the question is whether these training methods are applicable for state-of-the-art models. And I think, in principle, yes, but we have to take into account noisy observations, which for the moment does not seem to be a problem, but that needs further investigation. Then we have the problem of sparse observations. I think this might be quite difficult, but hopefully with techniques from data assimilation and nudging, we can solve this issue. And then there's also a problem of structural difference between the models, because so far I only worked with models that have the same structure, but just different parameter values. But of course, models, they can also differ structurally. So the idea is then what Francois also already showed, is to define a common state space, and then you could apply your learning techniques on this common state space, and then with techniques from data assimilation, you can give the imperfect models, again, their new state. So it's still a lot of work, but so far it looks quite promising. Thank you.
Questions? Okay. One in the back.
When you've defined your supermodel, like in terms of how do you couple the two atmospheres with respect to ocean and land, like do you make atmospheres like talk to each other, let's say, and then couple to the rest of the system? Do you think it would improve if, like, both of them, like, coupled to the ocean and then between each other, or do you have any idea of how do you do that and how could you change that?
So the idea is now that, I exchange temperature, vorticity, and divergence between the atmospheres. So then each atmosphere calculates its own temperature, and then they exchange that with each other, and they know the weights which they need to multiply, and then each gets their own temperature and vorticity. And then for ocean and land, they just receive a weighted average of the imperfect model fluxes.
Thank you.
Hi, very nice talk. I mean, the first is just a comment about the use of the convex hull. So once you get into these large models, you can't define a convex hull unless you have more ensemble members than the dimension of the state space. So I'm not quite sure how you use that, but if you look at bounding boxes, that might give you a little. Those work even with a small number of ensembles, and it defines a volume. But the other question was your previous slide. about how to move forward. And I think we all have trouble with this structural the structural uncertainty in the bottom line.
Which line, sorry?
Wherever it went. The structural parametric error, having the wrong parameters is really a question of uncertainty, and you can be a Bayesian. Having the wrong structural models, it's much harder to be a Bayesian. And I think the solutions are really sort of different. And we've tried to work by communicating between two different state spaces using observations, rather than trying to get one super state space, which the modelers will hate. And it is really tricky when there are actually different processes involved. But good luck. I mean, it'd be great if it worked.
Yeah, I'm going to try. Yeah.
Other questions? Okay, well, no other questions? Let's thank Francine one more time. One more question?